So I cordially invite all, welcome all participants from different colleges and from different professional practice forums in this series. In this COVID-19 pandemic time, considering all aspects of social distancing in mind and safety in mind, we at College of Architecture SBIT Vasad are coming up with our fourth webinar today, which is defining under a broad theme, decoding rural landscape, a PhD research by Dr. Ashwini Pilte, principal at MIT School of Architecture, Pune. This webinar presents the inferences from research study at Kullu Valley in Himachal Pradesh, observing exceptionally close association between nature and culture of people who inhabit these places. This study decodes how architecture is an outcome of ecological, social, cultural, economical, religious, and spiritual forces. I welcome Dr. Ashwini Pilte, principal at MIT School of Architecture, Pune. Has 20 years of teaching experience. She has completed her PhD from CEPT University. She has master's degree in urban design from CEPT University and bachelor degree in architecture from Pune University. She is an invited speaker and a resource person at various forums, including quality improvement programs for teachers by Council of Architecture. She has many research papers to her credit. Her particular research interest is in understanding sacred geography of Kullu Valley in Lower Himalayas, which is what she is going to address today. She received a Intech scholarship for preparing a religious cultural atlas of Kullu Valley. Her work on architecture of mountainous rural region is published in an edited volume by National Institute of Advanced Studies in Architecture India. She is the managing director of Pune Biennale Foundation, one of the important stakeholders working to improve urban aesthetics in the city. Through the activities of this foundation, she is towards improvement of city's aesthetic. She is working on projects like Pune Speaking Walk, transforming city junk to artwork, tastemaking projects in slum, and urban aesthetic projects for the smart city of Pune. She is the recipient of Anchor Panasonic IIID National Award by IIID and 2000 Asia Townscape Award by United. Hello. Hello. Am I clear? Hello. My voice is coming.
Yeah. Go ahead.
Yeah, now she is the recipient of Anchor Panasonic IIID National Award by IIID and 2000 Asia Townscape Award by United Nations Habitat in 2017 for her project Adaptive Reuse of Front Garden Bridge in Pune in 2017. We are very happy, madam, to have you in our speakers series. With diverse experience, I welcome you, madam, in this forum. Now I would like to call our principal, sir, Professor Shailesh Nair, to say a few words. Yes, sir.
Sir, unmute your
mic. Sir, your voice is not coming. Sir, your voice is not coming. Unmute your mic.
Yeah, thank you, Pallavi. Ashwini, you look different in the poster and different in the appearance.
This is post-COVID look.
Okay. Anyway, most welcome to the forum of SBIT's webinar. And this is the third webinar which we have been doing since last 1 week. Today also there are more than 100 participants already for this webinar. Yesterday we had this landscape series which has started, and you are perfectly for our college because our college is on the rural landscape only. So your topic will be most appropriate for our college atmosphere also. So I welcome you to our series. I hope this webinar will be very interesting. Thank you.
Thank you, Shailesh sir, and thank you, Pallavi ma'am. Thank you, Pallavi ma'am, for that elaborate introduction. And many thanks to Principal Shailesh Nair, sir, from Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel Institute of Technology, College of Architecture, for giving me this opportunity of sharing my experience with your students. And
welcome, ma'am. Hello.
Yes.
Ma'am, your voice is not coming. Hello.
Am I audible now?
Yes, ma'am.
Now, you're... yes, madam. You are audible. You can repeat. Yes,
ma'am. Okay. So, should I start now?
Yeah. Now, before you start, I would like to say that after the session, now the session will be your lecture. After madam completes the session, we will open the forum for question and answer. So that we can address the issues and questions regarding the participants. So yes, you can start with the session.
Thank you. Thank you, Pallavi ma'am. Again, I must appreciate Pallavi ma'am for this very thoughtful lineup of talk series. I must appreciate her perseverance and rigorous follow-up. Since last 1 year, she has been trying to contact me and asking me and requesting me to come on, come to her institute for a lecture. But unfortunately, somehow I couldn't make it physically. But this pandemic brought this opportunity to present my work virtually to your students, and I'm grateful to that opportunity also. Should I start sharing my screen?
Yes, sir. Can we share your screen?
Yeah, can you see my screen now?
No.
No?
It's not seen.
No. Okay. Give me 1 minute.
Ma'am, you have to click the third option, share content.
Yeah, share content.
And select the presentation which will be already open in your laptop.
Yeah, is it clear now?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, it's coming.
Yeah, thank you. Okay, so so let me begin with this today's difficult condition for me, that it is very difficult to conduct a webinar where your audience is a ghost audience. No, you don't even know whether they are there or not, or they are sleeping, or what they are doing. But I think today I'm not really going to teach you, but I will just share my experiences so my audience doesn't disappear. So my experiences of the journey of my research related to rural landscapes. So today's topic is decoding rural landscape. I'm not saying that this is my entire PhD work. This entire work is a outcome of a studio, rural design studio, which I conducted in a college, in my earlier college, Bharati Vidyapeeth. And then my research interest grew, and I finally landed up into finalizing my research topic based on this. Today, let us talk about rural landscape and their traditional knowledge systems. India has been gifted with various natural land, rural landscapes located in various regions and having a very unique character that is a result of ecological conditions, climatic conditions, socio-cultural forces, and also religious and forces. The variety of all these thought throughout India has resulted into a treasure of traditional knowledge systems which are grossly under-documented currently. Until last 10 years, most of the colleges, they never thought of this rural design studio. Since past 10 years, this rural design studio has come into the architectural core teaching. and it has really changed the way colleges look at the rural traditions and the traditional knowledge systems which we have with us. Because of the Eurocentric way of teaching and the Eurocentric documentation that we have, the entire system of learning was different. Why it's not going to the next slide? Okay, now I will start with this story of rural studio project, which was proposed by NIASA in 2010. And the objectives of, we were trying to figure out a meaningful dialogue on emerging issues of rural settlements. Then we were trying to develop a methodology for their documentation. We were trying to experiment with participatory approaches by engaging local communities in rural areas. And for this 10 faculty all over India were selected. They were not from one particular area. They were from all over the places. And I entered into this studio a little later. And interestingly, what happened, by the time I entered, everybody had decided which area, which rural area to take up for their studies. The moment I entered, here I entered like a student, not like a teacher. So I was learning. I was into complete learning mode. And I said, very typical thinking of a student, right? So I told Deshpande ma'am that, ma'am, I like to take spoken. You know, the easiest thing to do in Maharashtra is just door. And I will do the rural settlements in Kokat. So Deshpande ma'am said, no dear, that's already been chosen by someone else. Then I thought, okay, go to Gujarat, because I had studied in Gujarat. And that's the simplest thing, and I know all that area well. So I will do something in Gujarat or Rajasthan or Jaisalmer, somewhere there. Then ma'am said, okay, no, you can't take that, because that is also being covered by someone else. And I was like, now what am I remaining with? So I asked her the options, like, now where do I go? So she said that you have two options. Either you go up north or you go to northeast. So immediately my reaction was, no, not northeast. You know, very typically a student behavior. No, I'm not going to northeast, but north sounds okay for me. So we decided that let's go to Himachal Pradesh. And then, of course, the tourist fascination for Manali. So we thought, let's select Manali and study the landscape over there. So now here is a screen. Can you see my screen? Here is this small write-up about which I got from the magazine Frozen Thoughts. And I would like to read this here. History is not just about wars and dates. History is life. You and I are a product of history. If you want to enjoy the city you're living in, you need to know the history. The more you know about the history of that place, the greater will be the bonding with that place. The city gains a personality through its history. Otherwise, it is just mortar and bricks. To be able to enjoy anything requires relatedness to it. And I think we were literally stuck with this word relatedness. And we thought, let us explore whether these rural areas, whether we can relate to them, whether they can relate to themselves, and let's explore. Now, this entire documentation, this entire studio was divided into two parts. One was actual documentation and analysis, and the other part was design project. Now, yes, we went to Manali. Very, very romantic picture of rural landscape. And this is what we saw. It's like all concrete houses on both sides of the road, and just a single house with slate roofs, and not even that traditional, and all those wires of electrical poles, etc. Everything is spoiling that landscape. And then we went further, all the more terrible picture. Concrete. I mean, we were wondering why the hell we came here. Pune was very similar to this, except for the backdrop. Then we thought, I think we are on the wrong track. We are right now moving on the roads which are accessible. Probably we should take up a path where the roads Is the audio not there? Can you hear me?
Ma'am, it's
yes,
lagging.
Yes. Sorry?
Yes, we can hear you, ma'am.
You can hear me.
Okay. But I request all the students to please mute yourself.
Yeah, if all the students mute their mics, it will be better. They can clearly hear the voice. Okay, so here we decided, let us go into the interiors on the unexplored parts. And here we found that particular image of our romantic picturesque rural scape. So all these devdar trees from there, you can see here, if you can see my cursor, you can see a small little village hamlet here. And then, oh wow, we reached there. We walked down and saw this that we really imagined. And finally we found our place. And by the evening, we decided, okay, let's go back to our campsite and let's decide how to go out to study now. So you can see here, very humble. We had converted one tent to our work area. And one interesting happened. I realized that I had already shared a brief with my students. And the brief, I had never conducted a rural design student. I always used to conduct the urban design student. And the brief was very much similar to my urban instincts and my urban understanding and my urban background. So I had prepared group, and in that group there was a group called commercial area study. So all the marketplaces were to be studied by one group, all the institutional areas were to be studied by another group, and so on. A very, very urban kind of a mind. I was also learning. When I really looked at the village, where's the marketplace? There was no marketplace. There was one single shop, which was so humble, which was housed within one of these. And that opened only when it was acquired. When, like today's condition, 2 months ago, we were like, no shops open, and only one or two shops will open in 10 to 12 time, and something like that. And that was a shock for us that, oh, people live like this. So for us, it was really a cultural shock that, okay, there's no shop in the entire village, except for one single shop, which opens only partially. Interesting. And then I realized that whatever exercises I have written and the way that they are written, I cannot do it. And the students cannot do that. And then I asked, I had mailed that program brief to students almost 1 week earlier. And then I asked, I went to the campsite and I asked my students, okay, how many of you have read that brief? And, you know, students are students. Wherever you go, your college, my college, students will be written. Then, no, ma'am, I will read it today, and we've got the print. And I was like, never before, I was so happy that the students have not worked on whatever I had given them. So with that light in my mind, I said, okay, now do not read the brief, put it in the garbage. If you printed it, I'll give you another brief and restart the exercise. I'll think today and tomorrow morning, I will brief you orally. So I was thinking, now this studio has to be conducted in a very different way. And then we came up with our documentation. You know, all of you must have read Mr. Fletcher, the history of architecture book. In that, you see, one particular building is treated like an artifact. That building is studied from a climatic point of view, social point of view, cultural point of view, political point of view. So I thought that was the easiest model to study this particular thing. So I said every group studies one single house, and every group studies that house from climatic point of view, geographical point of view, ecological point of view, then cultural point of view, social point of view, various aspects, and studied that particular unit first at a larger settlement level, then at a cluster level, and at unit level. Treated, it rises up. So it actually goes here, and well, this is a fantastic example of interdependence or coexistence of animal and human. You know, they are absolutely dependent on each other. So you can see all these internal appliances, heating appliances, and these are our some on-site drawings. And yes, I explained you. Now this is how the facade of the building would look like, the Katkuni construction. Now you can observe response to climate. All the openings are very small. This is the door, and there are no windows here. So this is the reason to contain the warmth inside. If you look at this particular thing that is called as, I don't know what will you call this as, so they call it as sheed. And this sheed, we were like wondering how people must be using it, and we saw people, the old people, the kids, everyone used to quickly come and cut, cut, cut to walk onto this, climb up to the balcony, and we were literally scared to really use it. I think that urban taboos can never go. When how much ever you go there, how much ever you spend time, certain things we just cannot do. Yeah. So if you can see, the height of the openings is very small. Now they give 2-3 reasons for why this height is small. I will explain that to you later, what are their reasons for the height. But logically, it really says that climate is the reason, and they don't want to lose the internal heat to the outside. Now, when we drew this entire section, it was so interesting to know that this entire upper level, this is called as transect. We walk from east to west to the in the city or the village. We walk from north to south, and we actually, by walking, we mapped each and every house, every tree, every what you can call null or any tab or anything that came to us on the way. We tapped each and everything, and we walked. And this entire transect, we then realized, we started overlapping this with the socio-cultural nuances found there. Now we see that this particular area was a Devban, the green which we saw in the plan earlier. So where this Devban means the Devta ka ban, so the god resides here. So this is Jeev Narayan temple. These two are some Devi, Gram Devta and Gram Devi shrines within the Devban. And then the second level, all the amenities and the Rajputs stay here. So all houses on the second level, we observed that they were Rajput houses. The houses belong to Rajputs. And when we went further, we realized all the houses are at the lowermost contours, they belong to the Lohars and Harijans and the lower caste people. So unless we would have mapped this transect or this cross section of the village, we would have never realized that there is a socio-cultural influence in the settlement pattern itself. It guides the settlement pattern. And the last one here, at the corner, left-hand side corner, there is this Smashan Ghat. So this is how from God to Smashan Ghat, this entire transition kind of goes on lowering on the contours. Okay, this is the Gram Devta shrine in the Devban, one of my favorite pictures. Okay, now let us see how the typology of Devta. Well, we are now entering into the realm of little bit of culture. Okay, so let us see how did we really map the story is very interesting. How did we map Jeev Narayan Rishi's temple? Now here, if you see in Jana or in Himachal Pradesh, specifically in Kulu, the temples in the internal areas, they belong to either Rishi or Nag Devta or Kardu. You know, these are very either the natural animals or features, or the Rishis. Here in smaller areas, smaller villages, you will not find Ram Mandir or Krishna Mandir or Vishnu Mandir, nothing like that, or Devi Mandir. You will all find those natural elements revered, or Rishis. Okay, so in entire Himachal Pradesh, the Rishis are very much revered. And they believe that their devtas are Jagrut. Now here I would like to say that documenting Devta was very, very difficult. Documenting this particular temple, any temple for that matter, because their religious beliefs are so strong that they never allow anyone else into the temple except for the pujari. Even the people in the village, they do not go on a daily basis to go to the temple and pray, nothing like that. Here in Pune, we are like anytime we can go and meet God. You know, we can go and have darshana. But here in areas, You're not allowed to have darshan of God just like that. If at all there is a requirement, you have to make an appointment with the God, and the God will come out of the temple, and then you can meet God. So I will explain that story a little later. But here, what I wanted to tell you, that they were so restrictive, nobody allowed us to touch the temple initially. For 5 to 6 days, we were actually in front of them documenting all the other houses, and they were so reluctant to send us inside the temple. But finally, on the 5th day, when they saw our drawings coming up, and then they realized probably अपने टेम्पल का भी अच्छा ड्रॉइंग बनेगा शायद, तो देन दे सेड ओके, एंड वी वर नॉट रियली हार्मफुल टू देम, एंड वी वर रियली अबाइडिंग ऑल देयर रूल्स एंड स्ट्रिक्ट लॉज. सो आई थिंक दे फाइनली दैट पुजारी केम टू मी एंड सेड, मैडम आपको अगर जाना है तो सिर्फ 3 या 4 बच्चों को लेके आप जा सकते हो अंदर. वो पुजारी, मैं खुद ही लेके जाऊंगा और 10 मिनट में दिखा दूंगा कैसा है अंदर से, और फिर बाहर आ जाएंगे. एंड दैट इज हाउ वी रियली सॉ द टेम्पल फ्रॉम इनसाइड. वी डॉक्यूमेंटेड इट फ्रॉम आउटसाइड इन डिटेल्स, एंड पिक्चर्स वर नॉट अलाउड. सो वी वेंट इनसाइड एंड वी डॉक्यूमेंटेड दिस टेम्पल. नाउ वी वेंट इनसाइड विथ अ बिग इमेज दैट ओके, नाउ वी विल गो टू द गर्भगृह एंड सी हाउ द देवता इज, वी विल प्रे, माथा टेक के आएंगे वगैरह वगैरह. एंड देन दिस गाय टुक अस इनटू द टेम्पल, एंड फ्रॉम अ नैरो स्टेयरकेस ही डायरेक्टली टुक अस टू फर्स्ट फ्लोर. एंड वी वर लाइक, वेयर इज द गर्भगृह, वेयर इज द देवता, आपका देवता कहाँ है? तो ही इज लाइक, वेट, आएगा आएगा. फिर हम, वी ऑल वेंट टू द फर्स्ट फ्लोर वेयर एक्चुअली देयर वाज स्टोरेज ऑफ ग्रेनरी, एंड देन वी वेंट टू द अपर फ्लोर, एंड देन देयर वाज सिटिंग एरिया व्हिच वाज अनयूज्ड, एंड जनरली पीपल to have use it like bhojanalay. We were wondering where is the god. Is this entire logic of function, I mean, doesn't look like a temple and looks more like an elaborate house. And finally he took us to the attic, and the god was placed in a basket in the attic, and we were like absolutely shocked that okay, in this entire big house or this big temple. Am I audible? Am I audible?
Yes, yes ma'am, yes, you are yes, audible, yes, ma'am.
Madam.
Okay. Yeah, in between, I thought somebody said that I can't hear you. No problem. So, in this entire temple, we went up to the attic to actually see the God, which he really showed us in a very brief way. And just, you know, for a second, we could glance at the God. And the God was not a murti, it was just a face mask in silver, and there were many face masks kept in that particular basket. 3-4 face masks kept in that one basket. I was wondering, there are 3-4 gods staying together very happily in one single basket, and in this entire temple is empty. I was seriously wondering what kind of logic they must be having. Then I asked, how do you meet God? And then he said, okay, you want to meet God, then the God is going to come day after tomorrow because it is Amavas. So Amavas ke baad thoda refresh, God ko thoda wapas sanctify karne ke liye, hum God ko bahar leke aate hai. Yeah, sometimes we get the God out if some people have some issues at their place. If somebody is ill or somebody is some land issues are there, or some climatic issues are there, and that's when the God can, you can call the God, which is called as Pooch, Poochna. And this particular entire activity sequence is like, if I'm ill or if my daughter is ill, I meet the Kardar or I meet the Pujari or the, and I send a request through them to God that I want to meet the God. And then they fix up an appointment with the God on a particular holy day in the calendar. And on that day, the God from the temple, either the Nishan of the God or God. So in this particular case, only the bell has come out. This is the Nishan of God. So God's bell, they come out from the temple and sit here And in front of them, these people sit. And now if you look at here, he is the white turban person. He is the guru who actually does shamanism. Shamanism, you mean? You know what is shamanism? Where actually God gets into your body and you start speaking the God. You know, I don't want to question whether this is true, false, but this is what we witness there. So I don't really want to question anywhere that whether this is logical, illogical, whatever. But the point is, this is what happens there. And these are the beliefs and these are the practices. So if you see, the guru will sit here and the pujari and the rest of the people sitting here. And all these people are the lohars, who are actually harijans and lohars who use this the bhajantri they kind of play. So their level of seating is little lower. They cannot enter the sacred groove completely. So they have to sit at a particular level, and guru and devta will sit at a particular level. Again, there is a caste and class discrimination, you cannot say, but there is that kind of a landscape arrangement there. Okay, and then these are livelihoods over there. Interestingly, the honeybee harvesting, and then Shkulu shawls are very famous, and the construction workers. Okay, then interestingly, we did this Hindu calendar, Gregorian calendar, seasons, and the crop pattern and the festivals. And then we realize whenever there is a cropping activity, the festivals are not there. Whenever there is little shanti in their life, the festivals kind of are celebrated. Or, you know, so for example, in January, February, the gods visit Indrapuri. So the gods are not here. So you are not supposed to go and meet God. No noise made, no fairs, nothing, no activity related to God. Now if you see January and February, it's all snow there, so physically people cannot go out and do any activity. And that's how our cultural calendar actually overlaps with crop calendar, and that overlaps with our climatic calendar. Now here I'm going to quickly read those learnings. But and I haven't really revised them for a long time. The day when we saw or we experienced there and we documented that particular settlement in 2011 and 12, the same language I have kept it here, because that's the first impression that we got from them. So for example, we from interviews we could really understand that for any alteration or extension in a house, one has to take permission from the devta. Okay, now who is devta? Who will give the permission? The person who is guru, who actually gets into shamanism, who says that the God has come into my body and then I start speaking. So the guru, the shaman, he speaks on behalf of devta. And this also, what happens is, when God says no to concrete, one cannot build a house in concrete. And in Jhana, till we went there, the God was saying no to concrete. And very less, only one house we saw which was in concrete, but otherwise there was no concrete used in this particular village. And the whole reason they said that, nahi, nahi, God ko achcha nahi lagta, God nahi bol deta hai. Now, God saying no is actually maintaining the character of that place. Otherwise, it would have simply got converted into the way Manali has got converted, or the Kulu has got converted, or for that matter, Shimla. But these devtas, they actually control the character. They are like DC rules. You know, you can't do this, you can't move here, you can't extend your house. All these things, somehow when we talk about our DC rules, that okay, now this rule is there, I cannot extend in the this much that balcony in my front yard or whatever. So here, devta controls all that. And that devta means the guru. So there is a very interesting relationship. The second point is a strong belief that while entering the house, as well as while in the house, one has to bow down in front of the Gruha Devta. And hence the restricted height of the doors and floors. And earlier times, I have seen one few houses which were 200 years old. They had the height of 1.5 meters in the house. So this entire concept of Gruha Devta, that the Gruha Devta resides in the house, it does not allow to build toilets within the house. The toilets have to be outside. If at all the government is providing them with toilets currently with new different schemes, they are being constructed outside and not within the house. They do not find that culturally sound. So here we can see a clear understanding that the height of the floor is low because you want to keep the warmth contained within that space. If the height was more, then all the warm air would have gone up and got condensed or got gathered in this particular air zone, upper zone, and you would feel the cold. So the entire understanding of religious reasons and the climatic reasons, they actually match. Now the third point, the Jeev Narayan temple is not open to villagers for daily worship, but it is open only on occasions and festivals. And the pujari cooks food for the devta in the temple, and then he eats those two rotis by himself and comes out. So that means we believe that okay, cooking होने के बाद वहाँ से धुआँ आ गया temple में से, मतलब वो देवता जिंदा है, pujari is going and everything is going fine. Then interestingly, the Harijans are not allowed in the temple. They stay in different cluster on the lowermost slopes, as I just showed you the section. Then the barter system still prevails to a certain extent. Wood is exchanged for food grains sometimes. Then the traditional mode of measurement of construction is hearth. Now this point I missed in the drawing. The drawings also we created, as we documented the language, we also documented their mode of measurement. So one hearth equals to 1.5 feet approximately, but generally that hearth depends on the owner's hand. Whoever is building the house, his hand is taken as a mode of measurement, and say 10 hearth ka ghar hai ya 15 hearth ka ghar hai, so that is how they kind of calculate this particular this dimensions. Yeah, and there are a few more interesting things, that the central core, which was very new for us, central core in the cross section of the tree will always tend towards the north. So whichever is the north, that side of the tree would bend. The deodar wood is directly used for construction without seasoning, yeah, because of its properties. Yeah, and now you see their children, they don't have, actually they don't even have cycles, because this is a truly pedestrian village. You can't even drive here, forget driving, but you can't even ride cycles here. So these people only walk, completely walkable village, and they have their own ways of playing. Interestingly, the roof of the lower level house is actually the seat for the road on the next level. And here is the rural or the village seating area, seating kattas. And the furniture in the street furniture. And then you can actually climb up the slope and sit upstairs also, upside on the upper levels. These are our students and their students. And all those smiling faces. This is one diagram which I drew there on site after I came back from the site, and it shows that impression of this village was so powerful. You know, this sacred grove, from there we came down, and there were small little shrines and temples here and there, and these Bajantri people are on your left hand side. You can see these Bajantri and the larger temple, and all these roads, you know, across the roads are stepped, and along the roads are straight along the contours, and there are activities here, this loom of shawl weaving, and this is people actually enter through small villages. Somebody's washing here, somebody's sitting here, and then there are small little agricultural patches here, small little agricultural patches there, and this is what remained with me. And then the task was, now coming, after coming back, putting all this analysis together, what do we design? So generally in rural area, we had a practice of earlier years that, okay, once you come back from rural settlement study, देन यू गिव देम एक पंचायत हाउस और यू गिव देम अ मेडिकल फैसिलिटी फॉर दैट पर्टिकुलर प्लेस और यू डिजाइन अ प्राइमरी स्कूल फॉर द विलेज इफ इट इज नॉट देयर. And then we thought that instead of doing that, if we give them the extension of existing house which they were, they had documented, this entire understanding of the Katkuni structure, the construction, the technology, the traditional knowledge systems, the people in the house with whom they have interacted for 11 days almost. So that will get reflected in a very interesting way. And hence we did this exercise of extension of a house and people extended their houses. And this is how it came up. So this small little thing was an extension to the house. So it actually followed all the principles of the existing traditional knowledge system and they proposed these things. So I'm sure this was a big learning for our students. It enables students to understand rural indigenous design and constructional principles and also help them to develop an eye to observe, analyze, appraise, as well as criticize the same. It was delightful experience for the students to learn lessons from the settlement at Jana, designed by people themselves without any outside expertise. They really realized that they had no role to play here in these villages. And what the modern designers have been looking for, the eco-friendly is already available in traditional knowledge systems of domestic architecture. I think we should look back to these. And the Indian traditional knowledge system has lots to offer. There are the timeless principles and the continuing concepts that are still thriving. And the question here is, how long are we going to refer to the foreign literature like Barry, Mackay, Chudleigh, as standards of construction and design? Can't we not just go back to our traditional wisdom for references? I think with this question, everybody left that studio in a very nice mode, in a very positive mode. This entire studio was kind of a big learning experience for the teachers as well as the students. I always see students are very, architects are very egoistic. You know, if they go to a village, if they go anywhere, they say that yahan pe ye kam hai. If you would have designed it like this, it would have looked better. Then wherever they go, they say, yahan pe ek ye hona chahiye tha. Yahan pe this facility should have been there and it would have enhanced the character of this place. We are always in that mode of, you know, we know and we are giving. And this particular village and their practices actually erased all that ego of us. And we just knew that we don't know and we don't know anything. And when we got into that mode of not knowing things, we could really learn so much. I think it is very important to, because by our training in first year, I remember when I used to teach basic design, I used to tell my students, defend your design, defend your design, defend your idea. And whether these students, they have come up with that good idea, whether it is defendable or not, you know, I think it's very questionable. Why every time you have to defend, you should be open to other ideas also. I think that training has to go, that training of humble learning has to happen from the first year onwards, instead of, you know, trying to make them marketing people, you know, seeing their product of house. No, I think that's very wrong. So this particular studio, I think I'm sure that those people who learned from this studio, they will be extremely humble. And then we went to other places like Nagar Castle. Of course, I couldn't hold them together only in that village for such a long time. So we went to Nagar Castle, where that Jabbi Met movies song, famous song was shot. And the point of discussion here is there are still people, there are government aids and government is really taking hard efforts to conserve this. So this Nagar Castle has been conserved and converted into a tourist place. You can see it here. So there is a lot of opportunity for these conserving these traditional knowledge systems and learning from them. Okay, now this particular rural studio project I explained, it was a project which was conducted by NIASA and these 10 different places were documented. And finally, only three of us could come up with a paper and a proper book chapter. And this book was published, the Rural Studio Project was published in 2015. Huh? I'm just giving you these timelines. 2010, we started that studio project with NIASA, under NIASA's guidance. So they trained the teachers to train the students. So I was one of the trainees. Then we conducted this studio with our students in 2010, 11, 12. And then in 15, we could really come up with this present publication. So I must say that research and writing, it's a very tedious process. It's not a, you know, piece of cake. इस साल हमने काम किया, अगले साल पब्लिश हो गया, ऐसे होता है और नहीं भी होता है. यू हैव टू हैव लॉट ऑफ पेशेंस. सो आई रियली हैड टू, आई डेवलप्ड माय पेशेंस थ्रू आउट दिस एंटायर जर्नी. एंड इन 2015 आई ऑफर्ड जयश्री मैम दैट इफ नो वन इज देयर हेल्पिंग यू फॉर एडिटिंग, आई विल हेल्प यू एंड लेट अस गेट दिस बुक आउट. सो फाइनली वी डिड दैट. देन व्हाट हैपेंड, यू नो, फॉर दिस इज फॉर नाउ, व्हेन वी डू सच काइंड ऑफ स्टडीज, we from on based on the studies, our understanding, we can start writing different research proposals. So I wrote a proposal in this particular area and I submitted that to IMPACT. And the next year, in 2015 to 17, for 2 years, I got a scholarship for research project by IMPACT, and I created an atlas of religious cultural landscape of the Kullu Valley. So I'm not showing you that right now, but I'm just showing you how one studio can lead you to various different avenues. And the third most important was my doctoral proposal. Now, as Pallavi ma'am initially mentioned that I'm going to show my doctoral proposal, but I'm not going to show it in detail. I have selected very few slides of that proposal, and I will be sharing only that much which you can, as students, you can absorb. So probably it was really important for me that 2, 3 years, 4 years of moving in that area gave me a very different insight in that particular area. And that interesting thing about Devta, it intrigued me. So I thought I will really look into this concept of Devta in the Kullu Valley. Now, this Devta in rural areas of Kullu, the physical manifestation of Devta is not an idol, but it is a mohura. As you can see it on your left hand side, the mohuras, the pressed images in silver, you can see it in the one of the ruts, so, or the basket. So even on the right hand side, you can see all these mohuras, these are Devtas. So Devta is a pressed face mask and mohura, or it is a pindi, it's just a stone or nishan like bell or flag or anything. Natural elements such as vertical stone, trees, water bodies, they are also revered as Devta. Then villages do not worship Devta daily in the temples. They don't even have Devta's photographs in their houses. Huh? If at all they have photographs of Ram, Krishna, whom they really do not worship. They only worship this Devta, which is a local deity. And Devta is carried outside in the landscape on certain occasions for darshana. So darshana for people to see God, this God actually comes out. It actually moves in the villages. The God goes to each and every house. There people offer the God something on the occasions of some festivals like Phagli and Sarni Mela. And then the God goes back. Either the God goes back to the temple, or he goes to another village to meet another God. And this is how yatras of God are generated. And one God goes to meet other God, and the other God actually accompanies him. And then both of them start and they go to third God. So this entire movement of the sacred movement in this entire landscape is very interesting. Now, Devta moves in the landscape on certain occasions, as I said, like festivals, fairs, yatras, and also visit other sacred places. Now, here, while I was just wondering, what is this role of Devta? Why that Devta has been given so much of importance? And I came across one interesting newspaper cutting. And from here, from this Devta concept, my entire journey of PhD begins. Okay, so right hand side, this says two devtas have struck down the Himalayan ski village project. Okay. I was confused when I read this in the local newspaper that cutting was in 2006. I just came across that newspaper in somebody's house and I just read that and I was like wondering that how two devtas can actually struck down a Himalayan ski village project. So I thought, well, let me see what is the project. Now this is the outline of the project. Now let us see, let us see what is this project. It's a 2200 crore worth project. Proposed ski track, 300 villas, 700 hotel rooms, 7 5-star, 4 6-star and 6 5-star hotels, 5 6-star hotels, entertainment facilities, pad, and so on. A very, very big project which was funded by Ford Foundation. And actually the MOU between the government of Himachal Pradesh and the Ford Foundation had already occurred. And after that, this entire project was stalled. So I started wondering that, what, look at this, yeah, what is the power of Devta in this area? I was wondering how much ever we, you know, work hard, architects are never heard in the PMC also. If we say that ye rule ko thoda idhar ka udhar karo, the architects are never heard in PMC or municipal corporations. And here Devta is being heard by the state government. So I started looking at this Devta carefully. So my three questions were, what is the connection between Devta and this project? I started looking at that. Then why one has to follow Devta's verdict and Devta's rule? I was wondering, what is the role of Devta in the life of people of the Kulu Valley? Because I learned the entire cultural aspects, but not in so much of detail. Now I thought I need to really get into the roots of this. I need to get into the spiritual aspects, the beliefs, rituals, and everything. And then I started my entire PhD work on this premise. And I will not show the entire research model, etc. But I will give you a few examples. The first objective was mapping of all devtas in this particular Kulu Valley. So I mapped various types like this, Nags, Rishis, Kardus, Veers, and so many types of devtas. I mapped them because that kind of map was not available. I mapped them. Then this is part of that map which you can see on the screen. And while mapping, I realized during interviews and mapping, I realized that Jana, for example, the village which we documented, Jana is Bada Devta. Matlab Jeev Narayan, Rishi or Jamadagni Rishi's brother, Jeev Narayan, in that particular temple in Jana, is called as Bada Devta. So then I thought, what is Chota Devta? So I realized that there were 9 other villages in the surrounding which revered the Bada Devta. So all these villages, the devtas from these villages, they came to this Bada Devta, and then that entire thing was called as Devta Kshetra. Devta ka Kshetra utna hai. So then I started looking into details. I went back into history and then I realized that earlier there was a system that this entire land which I am doing agriculture on is not my land. Devta has given me for food purpose. So what I do is every villager used to give some kind of, we can now call it as tax, but some kind of offering to the Devta. So Devta, the Chota Devta used to have grain storage, and that's why we saw in the temple there was a storage of grains. So everyone used to offer Devta part of their produce as offering, as today we can call it as tax. Now when they used to offer that, the Devta used to store it, and then the Chota Devta used to offer part of that particular tax or that particular produce to the Bada Devta. So Bada Devta was little more richer. And then this Bada Devta and so many Bade Devtas in Kulu Valley, they used to offer part of their produce to the Devta in the Kulu Valley. So this entire system, when we look at it in a very different way, it looks like an administrative system. It's not only religious. Religious is on only on the face. So people actually, the devta will always have a devli. Devli is called as, is basically a devta committee. So that committee decides rules. So if you can see in this particular map, it is very difficult to comprehend at your level, but still I will try. This little darker dot here is the village which I studied, Jana. And then this orange circle encircling all these circles, this orange patch, it shows the Devta Kshetra. Now, because the rural village boundary map was not available, I didn't know exact boundaries, but I'm sure these boundaries would be little larger and all these Devta Kshetras would be connected. Now, here is Rumsu, Chachogi, and their Devta Kshetra, and then there is Soel, that Devta Kshetra, and this is Dhara, its Devta Kshetra. And when I realized the at a larger scale, Devta from Rumsu and Chachogi actually every year for Rudranag Yatra moved from this place till the last place here further ahead in Chanderkheni, after crossing Chanderkheni Pass. And this Rudranag Yatra, the entire Devri and the all the devtas in that area, they went to the Rudranag to revive the powers of Devta from its original place. So that was quite wonderful to know this entire landscape. Mapping was very interesting. Then the next objective was to investigate how religious activities associated with Devta help maintain this cultural landscape. Because I realized that the religious beliefs, you know, they emerge out of some fear. Always scared of God. Actually, we are always scared of something that is unknown. And unknown, generally, the natural acts in the on this earth, they are quite unknown and unpredictable, and we are scared. So when I was going up hills, I used to kind of maybe put a stone here and say Rudra, or the storm, the snowstorm. Now it is called as Rudra, God Rudra. So I kind of prayed Rudra that please, aaj snowstorm nahi chahiye, mujhe upar jaake ye jadi booti leke aani hai. I went there and it really didn't happen. So what I do is I passed on that information to someone else and my family that if you put a stone near that tree, the snowstorm will not happen. And this is a very natural thing. Next time, whoever has heard this story, चलो अपना क्या जाता है, लेट अस ट्राई एंड एक स्टोन वहां पे रख के जाते हैं. सो पीपल स्टार्ट पुटिंग दैट स्टोन एंड देन दैट बिकम्स अ बिलीफ. ऑल्दो मे बी 40% ऑफ द टाइम्स इट वुडंट हैपन, पीपल विल डाई ऑफ स्नो स्टॉर्म, बट दैट 50 or 60% पीपल हु डोंट, दे विल मेक दैट बिलीफ वेरी स्ट्रॉन्ग. नहीं मुझे, मैं आई हैव एक्सपीरियंस, इट नेवर ऑकर व्हेन आई केप्ट दैट स्टोन देयर. एंड दिस इज हाउ द बिलीफ स्टार्ट गेटिंग बिल्ट. So the religious beliefs, they emerge out of some fear, either because of nature as a superior, and they are either good or bad. You know, they are based on the repeated experiences of the people, and they are rooted or supported with astrological knowledge, astronomical knowledge, philosophy, mythology, and folklore. Folklore is most important. People kind of keep on telling stories generation by generation, and people keep on believing in those stories, and you know, they keep on acting like that. And then those associations which are built, they become very strong. Then these religious beliefs, they give to religious rituals. To cater these religious rituals, they are to cater to religious beliefs. They emerge as a solution. You know, and these are very abstract or metaphoric. Yahan pe ek stone rakho, wahan pe thoda lal tika laga do, yahan flowers dalo. गार्लैंड डालो, क्या इस पेड़ को थोड़ा लाल कलर का धागा बांधो. सो ऑल दोज रिलीजियस रिचुअल्स, दे इमर्ज एज अ सॉल्यूशन टू द रिलीजियस बिलीव्स, एंड दे आर वेरी एब्स्ट्रैक्ट, एंड दे जनरली इन्वॉल्व अ एजेंट दैट परफॉर्म सम एक्ट. सो फॉर एग्जाम्पल, इफ आई वॉन्ट टू गेट सम पूजा डन, आई नीड अ पुजारी, सो ही विल डू दैट एंटायर पूजा फॉर मी, से लघु रुद्र, वॉट एवर. Then it involves some acts and activities, and it involves agents. So these acts are either daily rituals that we pray. Here they don't really pay. Then the festivals, the yatras, the sacrifices. Sometimes they kind of cut the animals and give the blood of that animal, offer that to the God, that is a very popular practice there, though it is not legal, but we are not supposed to say anything about it. So, and then shamanism, which I explained, the God gets into you and that God himself appears and starts talking to you. And then these religious rituals, which emerge out of some fear, these religious rituals are catering to those beliefs. And to cater to these beliefs, there are religious institutions. You know, the temples, the dharmashalas, they are the institutions which write these rituals and say that this belief has to be safeguarded, it cannot change. So to monitor these rituals, these institutions emerge. They ensure the continuity of beliefs by educating or preaching. And the physical manifestation is either temple, dharmashala, or a small little shrine, temple, or the guru himself is a religious institution. The Devta committee themselves are a religious institution, which safeguard many things apart from only rituals, because the rituals are outcome of many climatical things, many scientific reasons. So here, if you see, the religious belief is what? This is a shamanism activity which is going on, which we documented. So the religious belief is Devta will safeguard one against any situation like illness, economic loss, natural calamity, or unknown threats to life or society or culture, and or Devta will destroy if he is not followed. Now here the religious institution is the guru, that person who is actually talking and telling that what to do, what not to do. And the religious practice is this: the Devta is carried out in the landscape, they sit in a particular way, then there is bhajantri, and then the people gather and they offer, and there is a dialogue. So all that puja is performed. So all these things happen. Here you can see their houses, you will see Ganpati and Hanumanji and everyone, but their Devta image will not be here. Their Devta will move in the landscape like this. This is an image where Devta is moving from the sacred groove. Yeah, the Devta is moving during times of festivals. That entire place becomes very dynamic and colorful. The entire landscape becomes sacred. Devta moves in that entire landscape. The, you know, from where he moves to each and every house, and then to the larger community area. So entire village becomes the temple in that particular. So here you can see how all these rituals and activities are actually related to the calendar, crop calendar, and climatic calendar. Now here you can see the example of Kulu Dashera. Now this is a revived picture. Kulu Dashera has revived after a long time. Earlier it used to happen, it was started in 1651 during the Vaishnavism cult. And Raghunathji from Ayodhya were brought here in Kulu, and the Kulu Dashera was initiated, introduced. And the Kulu Raja actually brought Raghunathji and said that I am not the king, Raghunathji is the king, and Raghunathji will only administer. So these are very religious political instances in lives of people. Probably you may not really understand that exactly. But interestingly, what I would like to tell you a story here, that Lord Raghunathji is the supreme authority, that's what they believe. And the villages, deities, they rule the Devta Kshetra. Now these village Devta Kshetra, Bada Devta, they bring their produce to offer the Raghunathji here. And then all 365 Devtas in Kulu Valley, they come on one day for that entire Dashera period, 9 days here in Kulu. And there is a lot of celebration, performances, a lot of rituals happen. This used to happen then. Meanwhile, after independence, this law was passed, Tenancy Act was passed. And because of Tenancy Act, the act said that jo kasta hai uski zameen. So whoever is actually working on the land, usi ki zameen ho jati hai. So in that sense, what happened was Devta had all this, Devta was owning this zameen, and Devta lost that zameen, and that zameen became the laborer's zameen or the pujari's zameen, who were actually working as laborers there. And then if the zameen was mine, why should I offer something as a tax? So all that tax system was washed away. And the devtas couldn't really earn anything in terms of produce. So what will they offer to Kulu, Raghunath Ji in Kulu? They had nothing to offer. And hence that entire Kulu Dashera was stopped. That ritual was stopped. Only because, I mean, nobody would have imagined that Tenancy Act can actually affect your cultural landscape in such a way. And that entire big time cultural event in Kulu, it just died away. And then it was revived. Later on, they realized that this has to be revived because it is a big time economic product for the Kulu, Kulu district. And hence, the government revived it. And now what they do is they pay the gods to come here for Kulu Dashera. So the entire activity has been reversed. Now the Raghunath Ji actually pays all 365 gods to come there and pray and celebrate. Earlier it used to be the other way around. So things change. Things change with time. Things change with certain laws, legalities, political situations, but they still strive. So I think this was a very important point that I had to mention, that how unknowingly certain acts of ours somehow influence the cultural activities. Now then, the objective three was to understand importance of religious governance in conservation of environment in Kulu Valley. And here, the most important thing that I observed was the Devban. Sacred Grove is a is an institution of conservation of environment. Nobody can cut a single tree in the Devban. You can't even touch any twig, you know, twigs lying on the earth or in the landscape. It becomes a very biodiverse area because it is not a planted area. It develops on its own. It is all the trees within the Devban will always have medicinal values. Only the guru knows those plants, and he brings those jadi bootis from these Devbans and actually uses them when he is treating people when they call him for pooch. Now, so this pooch is also a very important factor here. Then while Devta is on yatras, he actually surveils that landscape. When Devta committee is moving, I really experienced that they actually see if, oh, here the plantation has reduced. Suddenly there is a new quarry coming up here. This is not allowed. This is Devta's land. This is that, what, whatever. So all these things are monitored and surveilled. So here I came up with an idea of understanding of religious surveillance in a very different way. So there are no police to really check all this, that richness of the landscape. But these people, when they are on yatras, they observe it and they immediately bring it to the notice of the villagers, and then they act on it. Then the third point is very important, is Jagati Pooch. So I explained you what is Pooch. Now this is Jagati Pooch. Jagati Pooch is the entire world's Sansad of Devta. Now, this is something which has to do with my first interesting newspaper cutting, where the Devtas said no to a project. And here, the Jagati Pooch is called whenever there is a calamity, natural calamity like a drought or whatever. The Jagati Pooch is called, and you can see here. So in 1970, an emergency pooch was called because there was a severe drought. And 2006, 36 years later, there was another emergency Jagati Pooch was called, which was to address, to seek the permission of Devta for the Himalayan ski project. I think this is a very important parameter in the development of that entire project, in the fall of that entire project. That people came together and they decided that we must ask Devtas the permission whether this project can be done or not. Now, if you see this particular project, it had economic benefits. You know, it had a lot of stakeholders. Now, if you see the stakeholders, there were political parties, there were environmentalists, there were local communities, there were NGOs, and one of the important stakeholders was Devta in this particular project. Now, economic benefits, obviously, there were great economical benefits. The annual royalty of 3.5 crores to government of HP, Himachal Pradesh, employment generation. Now, this, of course, if you look at the political parties, if it is proposed by Congress, opposition raised by BJP. Then environmental implications. Here, if you see deforestation and so many landslides, slope destabilization, pollution, air, water. So all the environmentalists were actually against this particular project. Even Sundarlal Bahuguna, he called another Chipko movement. If you know the Chipko movement, these people used to hold the tree tight and will not allow anyone to cut the tree. So that Chipko movement was quite popular during that time. So Sundarlal Bahuguna actually carried out that movement in Kulu Valley. So if you see on the left hand side, all these villages, all red dots, and the Devtas were going to be affected. So there were almost 12 gram panchayats which were going to go in this entire project, and the new cultural landscape of skiing village would have formed. I mean, it would have really changed the landscape, the cultural landscape of Kulu district. But so there were livelihood concerns, and finally they decided that let us ask Devta, because it had cultural and spiritual concerns. And when they asked Devta, now this is the timeline of that ski project, that 2004 it was proposed, it was conceptualized, and then in 2006 it was kind of finalized, and then it went on, and then 2006 on 16th February this Jagati Pooj was called, the god Sansat, all the gods were sitting, and the gurus got into the shamanism activity, and the Raja of Kulu, the Prince of Kulu, he asked those shamans or the gurus whether this project should be carried out or not. And almost most of the gurus said no to the project, and the majority won. So this is how the decision was taken. And once that decision was taken, I was still wondering why the hell the Himachal Pradesh government agreed to this kind of a situation and this kind of a result. But then after studies, I realized only no by Devta, mobilized so many communities, and so many people actually started agitating against this, and there were elections and they had to stop the project, and after that they could never take up that project. So I will not get into details of that, but the whole idea is religious faith in Devtas mobilized the communities for environmental conservation. So that entire patch is intact till today, with all that cultural and social practices going on there. The reason is, one of the reasons is Devta, because once Devta said no, the entire community got mobilized, they came together and they did agitations and they said no to this project, and it just was stalled, and it's still not, they have still not taken up the project. So I think I'll not go into details. There are so many stories of such projects, you know, that Devta has said no and that thing has not happened. So I think very important thing as a lesson to learn, that religious activities or spiritual activities or these kind of cultural practices, they play a very big role in the entire making of cultural landscape of any place. And we need to identify those small little subtle undercurrents of people and their cultural activities. It is very important. Yes. So here I would like to stop my presentation. And I would like to thank so many people. They are all written here. But still, I would like to take a few names like Jayashri Deshpande ma'am, Anirudh Paul sir, Akhtar Chauhan, who guided me for the studio project. In urban rural studio project, and my guide, my PhD supervisor, Professor Dr. Kiran Shinde, who really guided me so well, and his invaluable and inputs at timely inputs. They were so important in this entire journey because this was completely new understanding for me. Of course, I thank SEPT and Bharti Vidyapeeth and students of Bharti Vidyapeeth who participated there, and my team at that time, Professor Rana Singh, and most importantly, the really good-hearted people in that village who really let us be all over the village, be all over their house. They offered us food, everything. I mean, they were so, I mean, great hospitality we received there, and so much of warmth, with so much of warmth they kept us with them. And finally, I bow to the benevolent Devta Jeev Narayan for his kind blessings. Yeah, and of course, I am very, very thankful to Pallavi ma'am for giving me this opportunity, to your principal, giving me this opportunity to present in front of you. And yes, now over to you, Pallavi ma'am.
Yeah, thank you so much, Ashwini madam. It was a wonderful knowledge gain session today. We really enjoyed. Now I open this forum to all attendees. We have in the question chat box, we have our one of our faculty member, Professor Pallavi Mahida madam. I would like Pallavi Mahida madam to ask the question. Yes, madam, you can unmute your mic. Hello.
Yes, yes, Ravi Mandle madam, can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
Yes, madam. Yes.
Hello.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, madam, we can hear you.
Ashwini madam, really. Yeah, Ashwini madam, really congratulations to you for such an enlightening session for us. And after listening to your presentation, we really feel so proud of our customs and traditions.
Oh, that's great.
Hello.
That's
yeah,
wonderful.
Yeah. Madam, just one question. I was interested in knowing the literacy demography of this area.
Literacy demography? Yeah, it is not that great. It is quite low. Every village doesn't even have school,
yeah.
But they
yeah.
kind of, you know, they don't study a lot. Mostly they get into tourism and then they get into
yes.
These practices, cultural practices, and they're not kind of, but then I have seen people, engineers, medical practitioners who go out from here. But one thing is
yeah.
there, if at all, if you are born in that place and if you go out to, say you go to Delhi for some work, by the end of your life, you know, your old age, you have to compulsorily spend in your village, your birthplace.
Yes, madam. Because because your presentation made me. Yeah, because your presentation made me recall the.
Ma'am, your voice is cracking. I can't hear. Your voice.
The teachings
cracking.
Which I usually do in my history classes for basically all the agrarian society.
Right.
Hello. Hello, Pallavi ma'am, your voice
Hello.
Is cutting. Yes. Yes, now we can hear you ma'am.
Yes.
Yes, repeat madam what you are saying.
It's not coming.
Yes, it's not coming.
Yes. So, it is basically an agrarian society.
Okay, Pallavi ma'am, can you just write that question in the chat box so that Pallavi ma'am can read it out for
I
you?
I can read it, yes.
Yes, I will do that, I will do that.
Meanwhile, we'll have one question from attendees, Darshan. Are there any specific parameters to measure the manifestation of culture into a built form?
I think I would say there are not specific parameters, this entire research was an on-ground research. So we actually explored each and every element, and we, I don't know whether this research is complete or not, because through oral histories, we still keep on getting new knowledge, which is still applicable to these places. And there is a khazana of oral histories and that particular traditional knowledge. And that entire knowledge is based on the cultural practices. And these cultural practices get manifested in any possible way in the built form, in any possible, from planning, from positioning of rooms, why certain room is not above the other room or below the other room, or the size of windows, or the material used, or the way it is interlocked, or you know, just name it, or the sizes, mere sizes. You know, the house is based on the owner of the house, his measurements, you know, the hearth. Hearth is whose hearth? The owner's hearth. You know, so there is so much to learn, and we have not arrived. I mean, nobody has really studied it in so much of detail that we can really make compartmentalize and say that these are the parameters you should study in the built. Every other person studying a new settlement can come up with different parameters.
Yeah, very true. Yeah, Pallavi madam is asking, what do you envisage for economic development for this area? Like, if the tourism option is not continued, as you explained from the project, what are the other options are given?
Okay, so the other options are, one is apple orchards is one of the important livelihoods over there. Then tourism option is there. But the whole idea is, you cannot convert everything into a tourist place. You know, there has to be a balance. Now, if you look at Lonavala or Mahabaleshwar, like, it is, the tourism is so overburdening that the land is not able to sustain that. Right now, we are actually suffering or going through this entire pandemic mode. You know, and there are many WhatsApp messages which keep on coming, and then they're saying the earth is really trying to get rid of man. Most many messages I have read like that. The earth is really getting tired of the mankind, and this race called humans, they want to get rid of us. And that's why this kind of pandemic. The whole idea is, for example, if Manali, if you take Manali, if you keep on increasing that tourism, as I showed in the first slide, when we went there, we never felt like staying there. We actually went to a campsite in the interiors and we stayed there. If I get the same thing what I get in Pune, the hotels like Pune in Manali, if I have to stay there and eat pizza, then why I'm going to Manali? If I cannot enjoy their culture, if I cannot enjoy their food, if I cannot enjoy their views, what I see is the next hotel in front of me, then not, and the river Bias, then why I am in Manali? You know, so that there is tourism opportunity, one should definitely tap tourism opportunity or potential, but there has to be a balance in that. And now if you see, if the Himalayan project would have happened, starting from Manali till almost Nagar, the entire patch would have been kind of washed away, and a new vision of high rises and helipads and villas and everything would have come there. And what happens in that, I had read one small, I received one small book, and the cover page of that I haven't incorporated in this presentation, but that was very interesting. The people, the villagers, they were shown walking. There were two pictures. First picture, they were actually plucking apples from the apple orchards. And in the next picture, the same couple was actually serving with trays to the foreigners, you know. So, and the tagline was, once the kings of the landscape, now are the servants of people, you know. So economic activity, it brought economics, but they cannot have that land, they cannot own that land, they cannot move in that land. So there has to be a real balance whenever there is a tourist tourism potential is captured or tapped. Does this satisfy your question? Does this satisfy what you're asking?
Hello.
Yeah.
Yes. Yes, I think Pallavi madam. Hello, Pallavi madam. You can hear? I think.
Yes, Pallavi. Yes, yes. Yes. Let madam continue. She was. Yeah. She was good. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Now yeah. With the same.
Next question.
With the same thing again. Before I go to next question, with the same question, I would like to ask that tourism is there in all parts of our country. So we can't stop that also. So how would we address from our research? Like you have done so much of research, intense survey. So is there any scope that your research addresses that this part of tourism can explore and this part of tourism cannot explore in such areas, such area to be neglected, protected or not explored in tourism activity?
Yeah, definitely. UNESCO is anyways working for that. They are trying to identify cultural heritage, intangible cultural heritage, natural cultural heritage, all these areas they are trying to identify and kind of limit their tourism there, because the whole point is not stopping the tourism, but if you see in Manali now, there is a restriction on how many vehicles can go to Rohtang Pass in a day. So these restrictions are important. Otherwise, if you pollute that area, then why will people go and see it if there is no snow because of pollution? So if you increase the tourism activity after a threshold, the entire tourism industry will collapse because it cannot sustain that many tourists. So the entire thing has to be very judiciously planned. There have to be certain restrictions that beyond this, you cannot increase. And then it's okay if I cannot go to Rohtang Pass this time, but I will go in there next time. That's fine. We will have to accept that. But we cannot spoil.
Yeah, very true. So managing tourism with concern, ecological concern. Another question I would like to ask here by one of our students. How the people of Devli, which you have addressed, or the Devta committee is decided? Is it passed from generation to generation or there is a system to decide?
Okay, this is a very, very interesting question and very dear to my heart. But I will, once I start talking, I can talk for hours together. But here I will just put it in a gist and say that it is extremely interesting to observe the composition of Devli. You will see there are females, there are males, and you will see there are Harijans also, the guru who actually gets into shamanism. To my wonder and surprise, he was always a Harijan. And most of these things are hereditary, passed on hereditary, but sometimes, again, there is a story. The God chooses these people. Now, before we go to that point, God chooses these people, this composition, if you see very, very carefully, there are people dedicated to bring flowers. There are people dedicated to bring water for the Devta. There are people dedicated to cook for cooking activity. There are people dedicated for actually doing the rituals, performing the rituals or puja. And almost every Devli comprises of 35 to 33 to 35 number of people, for the Bada Devta at least. And there are people who perform dances during the festival. So everyone has their own role. Somebody who manages, controls that entire thing like a jamadar, that no misbehavior happens and all, you know, everyone has a role to play. One person is for the record keeping of kitna anaj aaya, kitna paisa aaya, kitna kharcha hua, all that kardar, you know, all that khajindar type person, treasurer. So there is one secretary who writes all these things too, properly puts them together. So all these Devli is composed of various people, various types of people, and extremely important is Gur is from lower caste. And Gur has a very crucial role. Here I see we have some reservation quota, you know, in our regular system. You know, there is a reservation. Everybody should get the chance to be part of that larger system. And that actually I see here, that there is a reservation quota. For that particular seat, you need a Harijan. For this particular seat, you need a Lohar or a Bhajantri. For this, you need a Brahmin. For this, you need a Rajput. So fantastic composition. And I was seriously impressed with the kind of, the way they are following it. Yeah, in few villages nowadays, that making group of those 35 people becomes difficult. Some villages have only 10 or 12 people devotee because the people are not available. Some people are, you know, they leave the village and they go out first and then they don't come back in times. There are very less number of young people in sometimes in some certain villages. And then the devotee is smaller. And yes, then they sometimes they don't have gur, they will have to, you know, share the gur with the next village. Sometimes that happens. Yeah, does that answer your question?
Yes, ma'am. Then I go to next question. A question from Aditi Kaushik, from attendee. That due to the emergence of modern taste, Manali has completely lost. Why is there such shift? There is awareness that the Katpuni is the best for the type of typology and a culture they have. Still, why they shift to brick and concrete?
Okay, this is a very, very valid question that you have asked. Thank you for this question. I think this question needs discussion. We must understand that we are cutting the timber all the time, and now there is hardly any timber available. We are cutting, we are quarrying so much of stone, and ecological balance is lost. And that is why the government has put Timber Act in place. So one person in his entire life span, he only gets timber of some XYZ cubic meters for building his house once in his lifetime. Now, when I actually calculated the timber which was required for one particular house which we measured, and the allowable timber by the government under that Timber Act, under the Forest Act, that particular timber is way too less than what is required structurally. And then we actually calculated it. It is really less than 50% what is allowable. And now, and hence, I'm not saying that you must use timber and stone again, because it is really hampering the nature over there. If you keep on cutting timber all the time, and if you keep on increasing your building activity, that is not possible. The whole point is we need to, here comes our role as architects now, that we need to find out an alternative material which is as efficient as timber, which is as beautiful as timber, which is really not hampering the entire landscape. And I think there are people who are working on bamboo as a next material in this area. And there are a lot of research centers established to actually check bamboo if can be used as a next material in this area.
Okay. I think you have addressed enough questions. There are also requests that you share references of both the work, your studio work and the research, your PhD work, the references which you have collected to do the work. So you share with us also, so that we can also address and study with our students for further work.
Okay, so for this particular study, I have a lot of big list of references which I will share with you, Pallavi ma'am, then you can share it further. Yeah. But just to give a few important names in this area, Dynaik is one of the most important authors who has written very extensively on cultural landscape and the sacred movements in India. Then another
Okay.
author is Rana Singh, who has worked on, he is from Banaras Hindu Vishwa University, and he has worked extensively in cultural landscape area. Then one more author, Amos Rappaport, whom I always kind of revere to, that he has written a fantastic account of cultural landscape from a Western perspective. And from the Indian perspective, for that matter, I have also referred to Kalidasa's Meghdoot and Valmiki's Ramayana, because the entire writings, our old writings, are the explanation or description of cultural landscape. So then there is Nilima Thakur, Nalini Thakur, who has written good amount of work on this. Then obviously. Yeah, and OC in particular area, there are special authors who have worked. One is Sky Morrison and Jay Thakkar. They are CEPT, they did this kind of this publication in CEPT. Then there is this Pratyush Shankar. He has also a good amount of work on Himalayan cities. Then Shabbir Khambata and Swapnil Bhole, they have written about this area, and many more. So
okay.
I think if you Google, there is lot of, and I will share my list of references with you.
Especially, yeah, especially which you have shared, you have referred in this video.
Yeah. Yes.
So it was really.
Most of my work is basically a ground experience. Of course, the theory is theorized by somebody, but mostly it's a ground experience and on-site learnings.
References.
Yeah.
So that was really very amazing talk with you, madam. We really experienced the Kullu Valley the way you have explained, and the way the drawing made by your students and the writer made by you. It had really made us to visit by sitting here the whole day in Jana. Yeah. So I express a vote of thanks from behalf of our College of Architecture and Creativity Masters. Towards taking your special time in adding the venue to our special lecture series. I would like to thank our principal, Professor Shailesh Nair, for giving and motivating us conducting such webinar, making contact with experts like you. I would like to thank our chairman, Ms. Sri Bhaskar Bhai Patel, and respected trustee members, for motivating us and proposing such webinar. My special thanks towards our technical team member, Professor Taha Padrawala, especially,
very
who
true.
who had made this possible online with the team of architect Garbit Nayar and Rupuraj Purani, for making this webinar possible, and a very good participant, all attendees. I extend my thanks to all attendees for taking part and asking questions and making the whole session very interesting. So I express my vote of thanks to each and everyone. Thank you so much.
Yeah, before I end, I really thank you, Pallavi, for that continuous perseverance. You know, constantly you are contacting me and do this, do that, and thank you very much. Because of you, I just put it all together today. Thank you.
Yeah. Because your presentation had that continuous work right from the selection and all. I wanted you to come in. Thank you. Thank you so much. I called Taha Padrawala. I think. Hello.
Yes, ma'am.
Hello.
Yes, ma'am. Hello.
Hello. Sir, is there on screen?
No, sir.
Hello?
No, ma'am. Sir,
Naya, sir, is there?
No, ma'am.
Sir, left. Oh, okay, now, Taha, you can play our video or a screen of our college, or maybe a screen of our college.
Okay, but sound is not there. Is it okay?
Okay, it's fine. Yeah, that's okay.
End the session here. I would like to announce for the tomorrow session. Hello. Hello.
Yes, ma'am. We are here.
Yeah, I would like to announce for tomorrow session. Tomorrow we are having the same series on landscape design and architecture. The topic will be ecological science, site planning, and us by Professor Shishir Rawal. Landscape architect and ecological planner, an ex-HOD of Department of Architecture, MS University. We will have this lecture at 4 p.m. tomorrow. So join us on this lecture series again tomorrow. Thank you so much. I end this session here.